Today, the hysteria around a potential DeAndre Ayton sign-in trade reached a new fever pitch, as the Pacers have now cleared the necessary money to almost sign DeAndre Ayton to a max contract. And as much as they could send a really big offer sheet DeAndre Ayton's way, it seems like that won't be the case, and the ultimate solution will be a sign-in trade if, you know, the Suns are actually interested in getting a deal done and don't just want to re-sign DeAndre Ayton. And this whole sign-and-trade possibility really got people riled up, despite not really anything happening. I mean, some of the major reporters just said, oh, they're looking to get a deal done, but I mean, nothing really has happened. It's just been a lot of negotiations, we have to assume, and DeAndre Ayton might be on his way out. And there's a few different angles of how to look at this sign-and-trade and how you get the sign-and-trade done and what's the goals of the sign-and-trade. It's pretty complicated, but overall, just looking at it at a surface level, it looks really bad that you're about to trade your number one overall pick, who's also really darn good for being a number one overall pick. I mean, I understand there's better players in the class, but Ayton's still a very good player. As much as he might have potentially some motivation issues, we also saw this dude dominate versus the New Orleans Pelicans. He's been a great defensive player during these two playoff runs, and that offensive game really reached a new level against the Pelicans, as much as it disappeared against the Mavericks. Like, this guy is a fantastic player, and it's obvious why the Pacers want to sign him. Like, he is a very good player. It doesn't matter how much, like, we try to make discourse around him, he is a very good player in the league, and the Pacers have the money to pay him, so they want to pay him. Like, that. And Ayton wants to get paid, so I'm just going to assume if the Nets are not an option, Ayton's probably going to want to go to the Pacers, play alongside Tyrese Haliburton, and get another, you know, seems like he's going to be an all-time great point guard too, I'm just going to be honest, play with another all-time great point guard, and Ayton's going to have a good time there if this sign-and-trade does go down, because the Suns are in control here as well. They can decide to not trade Ayton, and if he does sign an offer sheet with the Pacers, they would just match it, and Ayton would be back on the team. Like, I'm still not in total belief the Suns' relationship is fractured with Ayton, as much as all these news sources have reported it. Like, Flex from Jersey, I mean, he's been pretty accurate about stuff this offseason, more accurate than he's ever been before. And he's saying that it's totally done. There's no chance Ayton returns. I really don't believe that, man. Every single time we've heard a direct interview from the Suns players, they say, we want DeAndre Ayton back. DeAndre Ayton is one of my best friends. We want Ayton back. We love Ayton here. And that doesn't feel like a smokescreen. It feels like these dudes legit want Ayton back. And I doubt it's some sort of big organizational disagreements. That seems more unlikely than the organization does want him back, and they're just exploring their options, because I feel like that's the more realistic thing in this situation. But let's just talk about a sign-and-trade, and let's just assume that the Suns actually do want to trade DeAndre Ayton, as much as I still can't really believe it until it happens. Let's just assume the Suns want to trade DeAndre Ayton, and it's going to happen in a sign-and-trade. How does a sign-and-trade happen? Well, first of all, the Pacers have the money to absorb that DeAndre Ayton contract of $30 million, and they technically don't have to give anything back, I don't believe. They can just give, like, picks. Like, they don't have to give another contract, that's what I mean. And the first scenario that's been thrown around a lot, which I'm pretty, like, unsure about, it just comes down to, this is ultimately going to be a three-team trade. I feel like I've talked about this quite a bit, but this is ultimately a three-team trade with the Nets for Kevin Durant. You want to flip assets from this Pacers deal to the Nets. So the Nets are also involved in this trade in their own way because, you know, they want some of the assets from this trade, whether it be first-round picks, whether it be a player like Miles Turner, who the Pacers have been actively trying to move for the longest time because Miles Turner is very injury-prone. He's not very interested in rebounding. As much as he can shoot the three, and he's got a pretty looking shot for him, he hasn't done it consistently during his career. And as much as he's a pretty solid shot blocker, actually, he's a pretty great shot blocker, he also fouls quite a bit. And this dude's just not worth his contract. He's not a dude the Suns really want if you're trying to win 60 plus games again and try to win an NBA championship. Like, if he had a fully healthy Miles Turner, maybe he would be an asset, but ultimately you want to flip him in this trade. So it comes down to, do the Nets want Miles Turner? The Nets want these first round picks from the Pacers. Will it progress a deal for Kevin Durant? That has to be an ultimate deciding factor in making this trade happen. What also can be a deciding factor in making this trade happen is the other scenario, which is the far more interesting one in terms of big changes happening, and change can sometimes be good, or at least it's different, you know, just being excited about change because change has to happen. I'm looking at trading DeAndre in for basically nothing. And you just say, okay, we're going to trade you DeAndre, and we're actually going to include some of our own money. And you send us back a bunch of first round picks. Maybe it's two or three firsts, which that's definitely not enough for DeAndre. That's the kind of the point of the sign and trade. You're going to get scammed regardless, because that's what I've said that again and again. You're going to get scammed in any sign and trade. But is it worth it? If you do get scammed in a sign and trade, is it worth it because what you get scammed, like what you technically get quote unquote scammed for, gets flipped for Kevin Durant in like a bigger picture deal where you didn't get enough for Ayton, but you just got enough for Kevin Durant? And I think that's something very interesting to consider. And I'm interested to hear what your thoughts are. You guys let me know in the comment section. Are you okay with trading away DeAndre for a lot less than he's worth in order to just trade for Kevin Durant, to get the assets necessary to trade for Kevin Durant? And I think I've already voiced this quite a bit, but I think it's worth it, because if it's ultimately not going to work out and you do get those assets via trade and you do get a Kevin Durant deal done, I think it's worth it, because your hand was forced. You know, you had the trade in and you wanted to trade for Kevin Durant more than anything. So as much as there's some in-between stuff where it doesn't look good, you did get Kevin Durant at the end. But then it gets interesting with that DeAndre Ayton trade. If you're trading for just picks or maybe a small contract, and this is the thing I've been going a bit crazy about as I've figured out some logic, my train of thought is, the Suns can technically trade for Andrew Nembhard, one of my favorite players in the league. I know he hasn't played in the NBA yet, but man, I love scouting him. He's my favorite prospect ever. I've said he is the perfect player for the Suns if he was drafted by the Suns. He was not drafted by the Suns, but he could be traded because he has not signed his contract yet for the Pacers. You can trade the rights to Andrew Nembhard and his cap hold to the Suns for DeAndre Ayton, and they could trade some first round picks as well to get that deal done. Andrew Nembhard, there's a non-zero chance that Andrew Nembhard could be on the Phoenix Suns next season, because I don't think he would be included in a deal with the Nets. There's a very, very possible chance that he could be on the Suns, and I'm irrationally excited about that. Like, almost as excited about that as trading for Kevin Durant, because I just love Nembhard. I absolutely want him on the Suns. He's going to be such an amazing player if he does end up on this team, and yeah, I want him on the Suns so badly. I don't feel like he doesn't even make sense on the Pacers. They just drafted two guards in back-to-back drafts, and they also traded for Tyrese Haliburton. Like, that's your point guard, shooting guard, small forward long term. Why do you need Andrew Nembhard? Give him to me. Give him to the Suns, please. So you're trading Ayton for Nembhard and some first round picks. The other very, very, very interesting thing that happens that makes this whole Ayton thing, like, at least something for me to think about, like, I like considering the details of this, because the Suns created a traded player exception. If it's one of those cases where it's just Ayton and you include some money, you could be talking about around $17 to $18 million of a traded player exception being created, which means you can either sign a new player into this contract, or sign and trade a player into this contract, or trade for a new player into this traded player exception without having to worry about going over the hard cap or the apron or whatever, you know, funky cap terms. You can just get it done because of this exception. And that's a lot of possibilities. And I think the primary one is talking about one of my other favorite players in the league, in Colin Sexton. That dude still hasn't signed with the Cavs, and it feels like it might be because he wants to go play with the Suns. Like, why not? immense levels of speculation here, but this dude has still not signed a contract, and the Cavs, it seems like, are willing to pay him. But if the Suns opened up that traded player spot of around $17 million, that's the same range that Colin Sexton wants to sign for. So you sign and trade for Colin Sexton, a guy that the Cavs, they're not going to be asking for that many assets because Colin Sexton's value is at an all-time low right now. And him signing for that much money, they're not going to request too much from the Suns to make that deal happen. You could potentially add Kevin Durant and Colin Sexton in the same offseason to Devin Booker and Chris Paul. Just figure out the rest. I don't care. You will win the NBA championship. I don't think there's any two ways around it. That type of core is going to win an NBA championship. And he's talking about signing all those guys down long term. That is just an unreal level of talent on a roster, a type of shot creation that's never been seen before, all assembled on a roster. I'm talking about maybe even better than that Nets team. Or it's similar. It's similar levels comparison, especially if you do keep a guy like Mikhail and find another guard on the bench too. Actually, no, probably not better than the Nets, but talking about other players that can fit into that traded player exception, you could be looking at Gary Trent Jr., Markelle Fultz, Lugans Dort, Kevin Huerter, although I don't really think we would want any of those players. Malik Beasley could still be on the move. He was traded to the Jazz. Luke Kennard has been shopped around, but all these guys, Pat Bev, technically, Gary Harris, I'm not too excited about them. Jordan Clarkson, if the Jazz do get involved in a three-team trade, is also in that same kind of range of a traded player exception of around $15 to $17 million. Everyone else, maybe like Dylan Brooks, Devonta Graham, I'm just trying to look at players that could be traded, Alec Burks as well. Can't really think of anyone else at guard. At center, I'm not thinking these. I just want to make that clear. I'm not thinking this off the top of my head. I'm looking at the contract website that has all the contracts listed. Other centers you could be looking at, Jonas Valanciunas could be on the move. Mitchell Robinson just signed for right around that amount of money. Brook Lopez, if the Bucks are done with him. Wendell Carter doesn't seem like he's on the move. Rashawn Holmes is into that traded player exception. Mo Bamba would be that same value traded player exception. Like this exception can last into the regular season where these guys that I mentioned, like Bamba, like Robinson, have passed their recently signed no trade thing, and then you could trade for them into that player exception. And you could look at Nerlens Noel, Jakob Poeltl's the big one, Isaiah Hartenstein. I don't know if he would also be on the move. Knicks have a few centers. Yeah, the Knicks have three centers on there. One of those guys is probably on the move. Wait, did Noel get traded? I don't know. I feel like he got traded. Anyways, those are probably the players the Suns would be looking at other than Colin Sexton to a traded player exception. The final guy would be Joe Harris off of the Nets. And that's just like scenario where, okay, we're going to absorb Joe Harris's contract so we don't have to give up as much in a trade. But it feels pretty unlikely to me, considering that is a lot of money to pay into the tax for a guy who just, you just don't know how good he's going to be at this point. He's just not, all the way there yet. Like he's recovering from injury. You don't know how good he's going to be. The last look we really got out of him was him just choking and really killing that Nets team against the Bucks. I mean, one of the primary reasons why they lost that series was Joe Harris just completely falling apart. And then we're talking about bringing him on the Suns for way too much money. No thanks. Trying to just think of anything else, but this sounds like Coffin Dance. What is this song? Okay, anyways, I'm very excited about a potential Andrew Nembhard trade. He could be on the move. Like, it makes sense for the Pacers to use him as an asset in this type of deal. And he could be on the Suns, man. That's the thing I'm most excited about. Other traded player exception stuff. Colin Sexton's also the other primary guy I'm excited about, because I love Colin Sexton too. Not as much as Nembhard, but if there's some weird universe where he got both Nembhard and Sexton, I'd be going crazy. I would be, and Kevin Durant, we got all three of those guys and figured out stuff at the forward position and center position. I would be just immensely happy, but okay, the last thing I forgot to mention, and I was like, okay, I'm about to finish this video, but I forgot to mention about how does this play into the grander scheme of the Kevin Durant trade situation. It seems pretty clear, if you're not getting a ton of value for DeAndre, it feels pretty clear that Mikal has to be on the move in a Kevin Durant trade. And I would love to be proved wrong, and I think Kevin Durant's value is just so low. I really don't believe it is very high, and I think the Suns could get away with scamming them. I feel like it's a very distinct possibility that they don't have to include Mikal Bridges. Like, once again, that is a non-zero possibility that the Suns can pull off the trade without including Mikal, and it would likely mean that you trade for Miles Turner and then flip him to the Nets. And the Nets are okay with that happening because, first of all, better spacing alongside Ben Simmons, who's under a big contract already. And second of all, that's a one-year expiring contract. So you just have that money next year, and the Suns can give them a bunch of other contracts that have a lot of cap flexibility, like Jay Crowder, Dario Saric, Torrey Craig, who are all in one-year deals, and Cameron Payne, who has a partially guaranteed thing next season. So he's also kind of like a one-year contract. And I think the Nets would be interested in trading for those players. As long as you have a bunch of picks involved with that, you know, six unprotected firsts and some pick swaps, or maybe less if the Suns pull off some scam. Like they're trying to not include every first round pick. So maybe they hold on to some of those picks for whatever reason, because James Jones won't ever use those picks. But they're going to hold on to picks for future deals and not overinvest into this trade. Kind of makes sense to me. And maybe that happens too, but that's a topic for another day. I feel like we're a few days away from a Kevin Durant trade happening. And who knows when this DeAndre deal, if it's going to happen, will it go down? When it's going to go down, then we can talk more about a Kevin Durant trade. Anyways, thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed and you made it all the way to the end, please consider hitting subscribe. And we're getting ever closer to 1,200 subscribers, so every subscriber really counts. Maybe scroll down, hit subscribe, and help me out. Anyways, I will see you in the next one. Goodbye.